Hello, investors, and welcome to our session here today. My name is Ken Rose, and this is Short Verticals. Have you ever seen a stock break through a significant resistance level just to see it fade? In other words, instead of getting the breakout and the follow-through you planned on, you get a fake out, a breakout, and then a fade. Today, we're going to talk about some tools we have available to us to help us to identify those breakouts that are more likely to come into play. But let me just take care of something here real quick. There we go. Taken care of. But that will be the that'll be one of our primary areas of discussion today. Of course, we will work with that from the slant of short verticals. We also want to review our previous positions as well. Before we get too far along, let's go ahead and pop through our disclosure. And just to remind investors that options do carry a high level of risk and are not suitable for all investors. Information here is for general informational purposes only and should not be considered an individualized recommendation or endorsement of any particular security, chart pattern, or investment strategy. For the sake of simplicity, the examples of this presentation do not take into consideration commissions and other transaction fees. We do use a paper money application here. This is for educational purposes only. We want to remember that successful virtual trading during one time period does not guarantee successful investing of actual funds during a later time period, as market conditions do change continuously. We will discuss the Greeks as they apply to our discussion. Do be mindful that short options can be assigned at any time up to expiration, regardless of the in-the-money amount. And in-the-money option has a higher risk of being assigned early. It's important to keep that in mind because the virtual trading application will not assign a short position early, which is different from what could occur in a real trading account. Well, that's that. Let's just jump right in here. I'm going to bring up the Thinkorswim platform, and we can begin our discussion here. And as that's coming up, just want to come over here and welcome everybody here. So welcome to Jim and AP15, Jody, Kevin, Alfred, Scott, Tom. Truth will always prevail, as well as Les Gold, Paul, and Chad, and Ray, and everybody else. Looks like we have Mike Fairborn over there in the chat window. Great to have Mike here with us today. Very knowledgeable investor. Do feel free to send your questions over there to Mike. I'll also periodically look over there as well to see if there's something that I can help out with. Well, let's go ahead and I'm going to give ourselves a little bit more real estate here on our chart. Take a quick look, see what the indices are doing. It looks like they kind of bounced up to the upside, but now they're fading a little bit. Here's the S&P 500. NASDAQ bounced to the upside, a little bit of a fade. And Russell bounced, a little bit of a fade. It looks like we got off to a good start, but now we're starting to fade. Of course, there is still quite a bit of time left in the trading day, so it'll be interesting to see what happens as the day continues to unfold. I thought I'd do here with regards to our example here, though, investors. I thought we'd start off by taking a look at a stock and look at volume and see how volume relates to breakouts. What I was looking at yesterday is a stock that has recently had some significant breakouts as it has recovered somewhat. This is a Disney. And on this chart, you'll notice down here that I have this study down here. It's called Volume Average. This is a study that you have available to you on the Thinkorswim platform. To bring it up, you just come up here to Studies and click on Studies and come down below Studies and choose Edit Studies. Then in the Edit Studies windows right here, make sure this box right here is selected Studies. Then just type in Volume AVG. And that'll bring it up here at the top of the list. You can highlight it and then you can bring it over. You can set this for various time frames. Because I have a 50-period moving average on the chart right here, I use 50 period for my volume. If I wanted to speed things up a little bit, I could also tie my volume to a second moving average here, which is a 20-period moving average. But a lot of investors will tie the time frame that they use with regards to average volume to a moving average that they also incorporate on the underlying chart. We'll go ahead and just stay with 50, for example, for example purposes of this one. Once you have that highlighted, though, just come down here and click on Add Selected. That brings it over. If you want to make an adjustment, click here, and that's where you can change the time frame, the color, and everything else. We have that on our chart right now, though, so we should be in good shape. Here it is right here. You know, actually, I'd like to have this line down here to be a little bit darker. So I'm going to change that line down there to a black just so that we can see it a little bit better. That's going to be a volume average line. Rather than purple, let's go black. And rather than one width, let's go two widths. That way we can see just a little bit better. So what I've done here, investors, is I've identified, I went back, I started off by drawing some fib lines on Disney just to kind of get an idea of where the recent price action currently puts us. You can see on Disney, the recent price action has taken us up above the 138.2 extension. Now we've come back down and we've settled on that 138.2 extension. Currently, that's holding up as a support. So if we're looking at this from a short vertical standpoint, it would be nice if we could sell a short vertical somewhere at 107 or possibly even below 107. Of course, we'll have to see where the premiums may be in relationship to that. But part of our discussion today is related to breakouts. And when we see a breakout, trying to identify, okay, is this really a breakout or could this be a fake out? Well, I've started here and I've gone back here and I've identified areas here where the stock has broken out, okay? Either broken out through a bounce or just moved through it. And the first one I have over here on our chart is right here. And you can see this is a resistance level. We came up here and we hit it here. We sloped down, then we came up here and we hit that same place. We didn't break above it. And then right here, we did break above it right here, okay? Now, where we broke above it, if you go down straight down below that, you can see right down here, this was volume for that day. Now, the way the volume average study works is it gives you the average volume, in this case, for the last 50 trading days, and it draws a line at the average volume. So what we're looking for, and as far as determining whether or not, hey, is this a breakout or is this a fake out? From a theoretical standpoint, there tends to be a greater opportunity that you'll have an actual break and run if you have strong volume on a breakout. And the other side of that is there's a little bit more of a possibility that you'll have a break and a fade if you don't have volume with regards to the breakout of that resistance level. So right here, we can see the breakout right here, the resistance level. We can come down here and notice that volume bar is above the average. So that would be considered to be a volume spike. And with that, we saw that the stock moved up 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, moved up for about 6 days, sort of sideways, but overall to the upside. As it was moving up, it was banging up and creating another resistance level right here. See right here, we hit it once, twice, three times, and we finally broke above it right here. So this is a secondary breakout right here. So this time we're breaking out of this resistance level. What was volume doing on the breakout of this day? Well, if I point my cursor over there, then we can look straight down to see where volume at. This is the volume bar right here. Volume was well below the average volume. So we may be a little bit concerned about that breakout as far as the potential follow through, and also for the potential of that breakout to possibly be a fake out, or in other words, a false signal rather than a true signal. And in this particular situation, that's exactly what happened. We got our breakout here only to see the underlying security fade down below that breakout level and continue to meander on down here. Then we come down here and we have a nice, we have a nice bullish bounce. From here, we pull down here, we got a bounce. Now, you can use volume not only for breakouts, but also for bullish bounces. So on that bullish bounce, the expectation would be for the underlying security to bounce and continue to move up and hit a target in relationship to this little bull flag we have right here. Well, what occurred on the day of the bullish bounce? Well, if I come down here and I look at my volume average line, we are below the average volume and we can see the bounce. We did actually get 1 day of a follow through, but then we faded and we meandered on down here to the downside, only to come down into this area and kind of settle down here and then get a bounce right here. Now this bounce right here, if we look at this bounce, let's see, we're coming down and we're bouncing. Did we get some kind of a volume spike on that bounce? Well, if we come down here, we basically hit the volume even. So we didn't get a volume spike. We did not break above that average volume there. And once again, instead of that bounce continuing, we faded and faded and faded and faded. Now, right here, we have a nice long candle and we're breaking above this resistance level. Right there, we can see that breakout of that resistance level. If we come down here and we look at the volume bar is above the average. So we have, technically, what we have here is we have a volume spike. Volume is above the average. You can see here the first day, we faded, okay? Then we actually picked up and got into gear and continued to move to the upside right here. Continued to move, then we came up here and we broke above this resistance level right here with this candle. And in breaking above that resistance level right there, we're a little bit above the average. Once again, we faded for a couple of days here, but then we picked back up in gear and we moved in. And then this is a nice strong breakout. You can see this resistance level right here. Resistance level right here, nice green strong candle right there. We're above the average volume, not by a lot, but still above the average volume. And you can see here, we sort of went sideways on this one. So one of the reasons I want to bring this one up is because this is not a perfect perfect indicator as far as whether or not we're going to have a follow through on a breakthrough or not. But I think you'll see over time, if you do this on a fair number of stocks and, you know, pull up a chart like we're doing here and looking at it over time, you kind of get a feel for first of all, individual stocks are a little bit different in relationship to this. Okay. But you see that sometimes you're going to have volume on a breakout and it's not going to get a nice follow through. But overall, when you do have volume on a breakthrough, you're likely to find some stocks and you'll see some consistency where for the most part, when you have volume on a breakout, there may be a pause the next day, but a lot of times it'll kick back in gear and continue to move to the upside. Of course, this one right here is a nice solid breakout. Here's a resistance level right here. Nice solid breakout right there. There's the volume spike right there. Perhaps it was giving us a little bit of a harbinger as far as what to expect from the earnings announcement. The next day we kind of held pat, then of course we did have the earnings announcement that propelled it all the way up here. Well, now that we're up here in this area, we've kind of pulled down here and we got a little bit of a bounce here on yesterday. You can see we faded down here. We got a little bit of a bounce here on yesterday. If you look at yesterday's volume was a little bit above the average, not much, but a little bit above the average. So I thought what we might want to do here on Disney is to look at doing a short put vertical on Disney based on a couple of factors, based on that Disney has had, and what I'm going to do, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to redraw these Fibonacci lines here. We had a separate session on Fibonacci a while back. But just to show you how to do these, basically we want to go from this area right here. Where do we want to go from this on this one? I don't know if I want to go from that area right there or not, because we want to look at, I'm leaning a little bit north, came down here. This is sideways. Let's see what this looks like. If I go like this, something like that. I'm going to go with the highest point right here. So usually when you're drawing Fibonacci extensions, you want to find the most recent run. And a run is where you have a base and then you have a peak. This is a lot of sideways movement, okay? So not a real clean area at which to draw Fibonacci extension and Fibonacci retracement. So I'm going to come up here to the highest point of this run right here. I'm going to start there. And I'm going to come down to the lowest point of the run right there and see what that does for us here. Right in there. Right there. And you can see that puts us on the extension side. It puts us at the 161 Fibonacci extension. So theoretically, this is a support level from a Fibonacci perspective. It's also a support level just by price action. We went all the way up there and we've been bounced along here. Now we're fading here a little bit. So the question here from a short put vertical perspective is, can we come down here to the 107? This is at 107.14. Can we come down here to the 107 or possibly even further below the 107 and sell a short put vertical with a decent premium? I don't know that we can, because we are a ways away from this as a result of recent price action. And we did on our bounce here, we did note that we did have a volume spike, not by much, but we did have above average volume there. That's actually saying quite a bit because it's so close to this huge earnings spike, which jacks up that average volume significantly. But let's take a peek here and see what we can do here at about the 107. I'm going to come up here to the trade page, hit that, and here we are on Disney. What we've usually done here, investors on our short verticals, is we've usually gone out somewhere in the neighborhood about 20 to 30 days. We want to enter a trade where we have a probability of success of 70% or greater. And would like to, when we look at the numbers outside of transaction fees, would like to get at least a 1% return for each day that we're in the trade. Those are the general parameters that we've been using in here. You could look at this and say, we're just playing the part of the investor that likes to use those general parameters. Okay, again, a 70% or better probability of success, at least a 1% return for each day that we're in the trade outside of transaction costs. Would also like there to be something technically that justifies, in this case, We have a Fibonacci retracement support level that gives us some justification. We also have some volume that is supporting a recent bounce that we're looking to provide us with some continued momentum. The upside isn't happening right now, but it is a little bit early in the day. Okay. I'm going to come down here to where we have. Here's 23. Here's 30. Let's see if we can fit something in here on 23. So there's 23. And we want it to be at 70 or below. That would have been the ideal on this thing. Let me go back over and look at our chart. I mean, I think I said 70, 107 or below. Okay. All right. 107 or below. Look at all these zeros. What's going on with that? Okay. So here's our 107. Notice the delta on the 107 is 29. That fits nicely because we want to have a 70% theoretical probability of success. If the delta is 29, that's giving us the theoretical probability that the 107 will be in the money on the expiration. So if there's a 29% probability that it'll be in the money on the expiration, there's a 71% probability that it'll be out of the money on the expiration. That meets that parameter we're looking for at least a 70% probability of success. I'm going to come down here to the 107 then and do a right click and choose sell. And we'll go vertical right here. And our vertical, so it looks like we're looking at a credit somewhere in the neighborhood of 19 to 25. We'll try to get filled at the 25, but we realize we may have to come down below that. We have said that when we're a dollar wide, we don't, on our credits, we don't go below 21. And the reason for that is when we go below 21, then the transaction fees start taking up a huge amount of the percentage of the credit that is actually earned. So we kind of put that as another thing we want to shy away from. That's getting a credit that is less than 21. But right now we're sitting okay here at 25. So investors, let me ask you this question then. If we're getting in here, let's just say hypothetically that we have to settle for 23. If we have to settle for 23, what is our theoretical return on risk on this trade? If we have to settle for 23, we'll try for the 25, we'll try for the 26. But if we have to settle for the 23, what is our theoretical reward to risk on this particular trade? Now, there's a little bit of a delay usually between the time I ask a question. I see some answers pop over there in the chat window. I think that's by design of our technology here. So I'm going to go ahead and answer my question, but by all means, answer the question on your side as well. Okay, so I've got here, I'm going to use 23. We will try to get the 25 or the 26, but I'm going to use 23. If we were able to get 23, the distance between the two strike prices here is $1. So I can take 100 right here, and I can subtract from that our hypothetical 23. And that gives me 77. This is our theoretical max loss, okay? That's our theoretical max loss on a short put vertical. When you think about it, if the underlying, let's say the underlying price goes all the way down to, say, 100. Well, if the underlying price goes all the way down to, say, 100, well, we've sold someone the right to buy the stock from us for 107. So we need to provide them with the stock for 107, but we have the right to come in here and pick it up. Well, let me come off that a little bit. What we've done is we've sold someone the right to put the stock to us. In other words, to sell it to us for 107. Okay, but if we don't have the stock, where are we going to get it? Well, what we can do is we can pick it up with this 106. We pick it up here at 106. Let me turn that around. We'd be picking it up at 106. Okay. So that we could turn her and we would have to buy 107 for it, okay? Because they have the right to put it to us. So we pay 107 to them, but then we have the right to turn around and sell it for 106, and so that results in a $1 change or about $100 a contract. So that begins to be our risk. So that's our max loss in that type of situation. Again, theoretical max loss. Then we want to take into our account our 23-cent credit. So that leaves us with a theoretical max loss here of $77, okay? That's if this thing came all the way down here so that both of these were in the money and both of those would be exercised, would be buying the stock for 106 because we sold someone the right to put it to us, but then we could turn around and exercise our right because we're long on this one to put it to someone at 106. That limits our gain, that limits our loss somewhat in that type of a situation. But here's our 77. I'm going to take that 77 divided by the 23. So 23 divided by 77 gives us a theoretical return on risk of 29%. We're going to be in the trade for okay. I'm hearing something in the background here. I'm thinking we're okay. We're good. Okay, good. Okay, good. Okay, great. Okay, so we're looking right here. And so if we went down to a 106, let's see if we can still get a 21 or better credit here. If we went just a little bit further away, I'm going to go on the 107 here. I'm going to come over here, go to 106, and then we're going to take this down to 105. That brings us right down barely to 121. So I'm going to go back up here to the 107. Give us a little bit more room here, 107, 106. Okay, so we're set there. So how many contracts do we want to do then on this one, investors? Well, we'll pull up a little calculator right here, and our theoretical max loss, if we get filled at 23, is going to be 77. Let's say we're okay risking $500. 500 divided by 77 bucks would be six of these contracts. One, two, three, four, five, six. So there we are with six of them. Okay. I'm going to come over here and do a confirm then. And we're going to try to get we're going to try to get 25 here if we can. Short verticals, sand. Whenever this box comes up, you always want to review it. Notice we have our max loss here is at 525. So it's a little bit over the 500 bucks. We might want to, oh, you know what? That's because that's at seven. Well, let's come in here and see, that shouldn't be that high. That's where we want to be. There's our max loss at 444. So that's where we want to be. We come in here, we have transaction fees and the rest, and we come down here. Please note you've selected a weekly option series with non-standard expiration date, okay? So with that, we can go ahead and click on send. And we got filled at the 26. Now, investors, this is a paper money application. So keep that in mind. The paper money application tends to be more forgiving than an actual live trading situation. So if you're in an actual live trading account and you're doing a transaction similar to this, you may not get filled at the 26. You may have to settle for 25, 23, 22. You may not be able to get filled at 21. Okay. It's a possibility. Now, to be honest, I have seen situations in a live trading account where it has been just as forgiving as a paper trading account. But to be on the safe side, because it isn't always that way, I would just consider that your live trading account is going to be more stringent than the paper trading account. All right, I just want to come back over here and check any questions over here in the chat window that I may be able to help out with before we venture in and take a look at our current positions. I want to see what's going on. And it looks like our sound came back on. I wonder why it went off, to be honest with you. Okay, but it looks like sound is good. That's good to hear. Good to know that. I was testing to see if you guys were sleeping. No, that wasn't it. I'm not sure why the sound went off. But it looks like you guys, I do see several no sounds here. That is odd. Oh. Okay, we're good. Okay, and I'm not seeing any questions over there, so we're good. So, folks, if there's something that I did here when the sound was off, and you'd like to kind of review that, feel free to chat that in the chat window. And I'm more than happy to kind of move back and to catch that as well. Okay, all righty. So let's see how we're doing here, though. Let's come over here to the monitor tab then, and take a look. Here's our Disney position, which we just opened. And it looks like on Disney, we've got 23 days till expiration. everything is set up. It looks like we got off to a good start, but a lot of times that's just related to the slippage between the bid and the ask price. We come down here to Tesla. I believe we put Tesla on about 3 weeks ago. On Tesla, we have 2 days till expiration. We're sitting here at 46 level of profitability. Okay, so we're sitting there at 46 level of profitability. We have 2 days. The price is at 185 and our short strike price is at 177.50. So the question always becomes on this, do we want to take our profit now or do we want to hold off for the next 2 days to see what else we can capture on this? Well, to make that determination, we'll want to look at our maximum gain and we'll also want to look at the chart to see what this looks like. And we're going to pull up Tesla. And let's come back here and grab 30 days, Tesla. So we got a credit of 47 and we got two of those credits. What is that? That's going to be $94 would be our maximum gain on this because we have two of those, $94. So we're sitting at, let's just say a little bit less than half that, if we can get out at a favorable price. Now, these are estimates. You don't really know how it's going to turn out until you exit the trade because you're not sure where you'll be able to get out. Our short strike price is at 177.50. Let's take a look at the chart here on Tesla. T-S-L-A. On Tesla, if some of you remember, this is kind of our first endeavor into the Fibonacci land, and we identified this as a Fibonacci support level. We're sitting here at the bottom of that channel, but the channel's held up pretty good. We did drop out of it one day, only to get back into it the second day. So that channel has held up pretty good. I'm going to go ahead and play the part of the investor. Let's see. Let me look at that one more time. I want to look at that 177.50. And one, so right here, folks, that is, in fact, let's draw a line here. Okay. And let's set that line at 177.50, 177.50. Okay. So as long as we stay above this line, we should be in pretty good shape. We should be. Now, do keep in mind that even though an option is out of the money, there is still the possibility that it could be exercised or assigned. It's not likely, but it is a possibility. Our support line's holding up okay. I'm going to go ahead and play the part of the investor that's okay hanging in here with this sideways channel that we identified as part of the Fibonacci. I may regret playing that part, but I'm going to go ahead and play the part here today. One of the reasons is these are small candles. We had a doji yesterday. We have a doji today. When you have these doji candlesticks, either at a resistance level or at a support level, they do indicate that the stock has found support in this case or has found resistance in this case. It's not guaranteed, okay, but it is an indication of that possibility. So we'll go ahead and hold on to that and look for those to go through expiration, hopefully not get assigned, and capture the additional 50% of our profit that we're looking at right there, okay? So it's Tesla. Here's Taiwan Semiconductor. We did Taiwan Semiconductor last week. It looks like it's in good shape. We have 16 days till expiration. Our short strike price is at 118. We're currently trading at 128, and we're moving up, so that looks good. This is our XSP. This is a mini index option on the S&P 500. The nice thing about this is it's European style. What's nice about that? The nice thing about it is these options cannot be exercised or assigned before the expiration. So that's one area that you don't need to be concerned about. You still want to be concerned about price movement. It looks like it's doing okay here. We have 9 days till expiration. We're currently trading at 497.39. It gets into some difficulty here at 483. Well, let's take a look at the chart and keep this in mind, 483. So come up here to the chart here and right here. So that was, what was that price? 489.43, right? Come back over here and no, it was 483, okay? 483. Now the micro that we're using is 1/10 of the regular index that we're seeing right here. Okay, so 489 is going to be 483 is going to be right there. Okay, so it looks like we are in pretty good shape as far as that. It looks like we sold this down below this level right here. And it looks like so far that that's holding up. So it looks like that one is in good shape as well. Now, investors, some of you remember that we had a secondary index trade, and we did that index trade on the Russell. Okay, and the Russell expired recently. So let's take a look at this one. Come over here and pull up the Russell. We need to go back a few days in order to capture this. There's our trade. So you can see that there was no exit on this. You know, that's one of the nice things about a European style option, of which the MRUT is. This is a micro Russell contract. That is that there's no exercise or assignment until the expiration date. Okay. And these generally, you're looking at them being in the money for that to occur. So you don't need to worry quite as much. And then when they go through the expiration, they're basically cashed out for you. You don't have to go in and close anything. They just basically cash out for you. Now, the other nice thing about these ones, the micros, they actually trade all the way through the Friday of expiration. Some of the other index options, they'll cease trading on Thursday, and then you're not sure exactly where you're at until the following morning on Friday, where you have the first print. But that's not the case on the micros that we're looking at right here. They actually trade on that Friday. So the important thing on this one is that on Friday the 9th, the underlying security, in other words, the Russell, was above 192.50 there. So let's come over here, and I'm just going to make a note here. We're talking about the 9th of February, and we're talking about 192.50. So I'm going to come over here and look at it over here. We don't have to mess around with the math so much. MRUT. Well, you can see it's kind of bounced along here. I think we probably took it as it was right here, as it was breaking above that resistance level. Where were we on the 9th? Well, here is the 8th, and here is the 9th, and we closed on the 9th. We closed at 201, so we were a long ways away from where the trade would get into some difficulty. Since then, it's come up and had a huge move down here to the downside. Looks like we'd still be in pretty good shape here today because we're sitting here at 199. So that trade was nice. And that trade basically resulted in the maximum gain, okay? Well, that completes our review then, investors, of our existing positions. Just a review overall, just a reminder that we've been doing these short verticals in this class since back in July of 2020. We've now completed 192 trades. On those trades, we've been successful on 81.7 of those trades. We've also been unsuccessful on 18.5 of those trades. Our average return on risk, and this includes losing trades, has been 16.32%. Our average days in the trade have been 13.64. Now, the question almost always comes up, how come our average days in the trade, it's like 13, and we're usually going out 20 to 30. But we do a fair number of earnings trades. And on those earnings trades, sometimes we're only in those trades for possibly 2 to 3 days, usually max when we're doing those earnings trades. Well, how are we doing on time, investors? Hey, you know what? It looks like we got a little bit of time. I'm going to come over here and take one more peek over there in the chat window, see if, let's see, AP, Ken, what is the ATR on Disney? Well, we can take a look at that. I don't think there's any harm in that. Disney. D-I-S. Okay, we're saying, so we did a 107. Okay, what's the ATR? How far away are we currently from an ATR perspective on Disney? Because sometimes we'll look at that. Well, I'm going to bring up a study here. She's at its study. And let's bring up ATR here for Disney King and add that. And let's make this big enough so we can see it. Right there, we'll make that a 2. There we are right there. Okay, so the ATR on Disney right now is 266, okay? So if we're looking at this from an ATR perspective, and sometimes we do that, sometimes we'll run that number, okay? I'm gonna look at the ATR here of 266, and then I wanna look at the distance between where we're currently trading in our short strike price. And our short strike price was at 107, right? So we're currently sitting here at 110. So let's grab our calculator here. Okay. And we've got 110.46 minus our short strike price, which is 107. So that's 346. That's the distance between where the stock is currently trading at and the top part of our short vertical is $3.46. That number in and of itself doesn't mean a whole lot, but if we divide that by the ATR, then that kind of ties it into the volatility of the underlying stock. What we've liked to hit in the past would be to have this number to be at least 1.5 ATRs, but let's see where we're at on this one. 346 divided by 266, 2.66. We're sitting at about a 1.3, okay? So we are sitting about a 1.3 ATRs. On a fair number of our trades, this number approaches 1.5. So this one's a little bit tighter. You could even say a little bit more risky, okay? And we would include that in our analysis and keep that in mind. Also keeping in mind that where we're sitting at here with regards to Fibonacci proportions, taking into consideration this bounce started with above average volume, not by much, but still above average volume. And will this bounce fade a day and then continue to move up? Well, we'll see what happens over time. We don't know at this particular point in time. That is a great question on that as well. Okay. All right. So how are we doing over here, Investor One? Catch any other questions maybe that I can help out with? Yeah. Let's see. It looks like Mike's doing a great job. I've taken good care of you guys. Let's see. Ken, could a short position of a vertical be closed prior to expiration, leaving just the long position open? Absolutely, John. Yeah, you can absolutely do that. And in fact, one of the things you can do, maybe I can show this graphically to you, is let's just say I'm going to use freehand here, and it's almost embarrassing, particularly since over the chat window, we have the most steady hand in the coaching department, and that would be Mike Fairborn. If you've ever seen him draw freehand, it's a work of art. Mine is not a work of art, okay? But let's say that this is our, short, that's our short option right there, okay? And then this is our, and this is a short put vertical. And this is our long option right here, like so. Okay, and let's say the distance between these two is $1. Okay, and the price gaps. The price takes this huge gap in the morning. The price comes all the way down here. Takes this big gap in the morning. So both of these guys are in the money. We're sitting at maximum loss, and maybe we have 5 or 6 days left in the trade. Well, something to keep in mind is if it's blown through both of these, the delta on this long option is probably going to be somewhere in the neighborhood of about, and it depends on where you're at in relationship to expiration as well as the strength of this gap, but it's not unusual to see the delta on that long option be somewhere in the neighborhood of about 70, which would mean the delta on the short option probably be somewhere in the neighborhood of 80 or 90. Okay, we're seeing our maximum gain. We could come in and buy back the short option, okay? So we come in here and we buy this back. And we're gonna pay for it, okay? We're gonna pay for it, but think about it from this standpoint, folks. From a theoretical perspective, the difference in price between these two options say $1.25, because the distance between the strike price is $1. And the closer you get to expiration, the more the difference becomes $1. Okay, but let's just say $1.25. So we come in and we buy this back. When we do this, we open ourselves up to more risk than we had when we originally entered the trade. However, now we have our long option with a delta of 70. So how far does that stock have to move in order to recoup the $1.25? Well, it's going to have to move about $2. And if it's moving quickly, that can happen relatively quickly. The problem with that is if it moves the opposite direction, then you could be stuck with a loss that's greater than your max loss. But yes, you could buy back the short option and you can do that early. All right, investors, let's go ahead and wrap things up here for today, okay? I think we've gone through a lot of stuff here and we want to be careful about that. And let's see, got one question here. I've got time for this. Let's see. Yeah, looks like I've got some time here from Virginia. What would be a less tight short put vertical for Disney? Lower strike price. So for Disney, if we wanted to go lower, okay, if we wanted to go lower than the 107, we could go to a 106 and we could move further and further away from here. The challenge you get when you do that is your reward to risk deteriorates. So if you have one losing trade, it's probably going to take you two or three or maybe even four successful trades in order to make that up. But you can come, you know, rather than 107, if you wanted to go further out, you could come down here to 106, to 105. How about a 105? If I come down here to 105, same time frame, and I sell a vertical. I sell the vertical right this, okay? And I'm getting maybe 15 cents. So I'm risking 15 cents to make 15 cents. If this trade gets blown out, think how many trades I need to do in order to make that back. Now, the other thing you can do is you can go out further in time. If we went out 60, let's come out here 43. Vertical. We go out 40 days. Now I have a nice premium, but now I have to forecast the stock for 43 days rather than 23 days. And if we're okay with that, if you feel like the long-term trend is to the upside, then there's nothing wrong with that. All right, everybody, let's go ahead and wrap things up here today before we get caught on time, okay? Hey, for today, well, we talked about short verticals. We talked about important considerations. Then we particularly talked about volume to avoid false signals. It's not perfect, but it can definitely help us to do that. We also follow the steps and we place an example short vertical trade as well. Just a little reminder, you can follow me on X, formerly Twitter. My handle is @KenRoseCS. I also encourage you to follow Mike on X as well. He posts a lot of great information over there. I believe, Mike, your handle over there is @MikeFairbornCS. Also, circle your calendars for Mondays. That's going to be Mondays at, I think it's 2 o'clock. I believe it's 2 o'clock. I'm almost sure it's 2 o'clock. Circle your calendars for Mondays at 2 o'clock. Mike teaches an excellent covered calls and short puts session as well. And coming up here following our session here today, we have Cameron May teaching managing an option portfolio. So hang around for that excellent session as well. Hey, everybody, thanks again for joining us here today. Hey, just a little bit of a heads up. If you look at the bottom right corner of your YouTube window, you'll see a little subscribe button there. And I'd strongly encourage you to hit that subscribe button. That will put you in a great place to be kept up to date with all the latest and greatest from the Trader Talks channel. And you can join the thousands and thousands and thousands of other subscribers that are currently benefiting from doing so. Hope you have a great afternoon and evening, a fantastic rest of your week, and hope to see you back here again next time. Bye, everybody. We'll see you. Thanks again.